Hey, everybody, it's Mark Pattison. I'm back again for another great episode of Finding Your Summit, all about people overcoming adversity and finding their way. And I'm really jacked up about this week's guest, Steve Azar, my longtime pal from the great state of Mississippi. But before we get there, I just want to remind everybody, if you want to check out what's going on my end, I got a new website that I put up, markpattisonnfl.com. You can see it down below. And on there, you can find out something called Amelia's Everest, a project I've been working out for quite a while. I'm very jacked up because we've just added Higher Ground as a new collaborator, just an outstanding organization to help me raise money. We've actually calling this one called Amelia's Everest, the Lhotse Challenge. Also trying to take on that mountain next year, 2021, after I go up and down Mount Everest. Also my public speaking. And of course, you can follow me on the blog. I also put a countdown, and I think right now I'm 10 months, 3 days, and about 50 minutes away from leaving to Kathmandu. So I'm really jacked up about that. All right, man. So I want to start the show off today with a quote that I put up on the board. And for me to do that, I need to start by putting my glasses on here. So train your mind to see the good in everything. Positivity is a choice. The happiness in your life depends on the quality of your thoughts. And I want to introduce my guest today because I think he just eludes, or whatever the word is, exudes, that's the word, positivity has for a long time. Steve Azar, how you doing?
Hey, Brother Mark. Thank you for having me on again. We have a repeat performance. You could be the first that ever allowed me on twice.
Well, actually, I hate to tell you this, but Hugh Millen came on last week as well. And Jim Moore came on the week before that. Yeah, so you're number three. But anyways, for everybody who doesn't know you, you're a guy that I've known for a long time. I got to meet you many years ago down in New Orleans. Actually, my roommate, my longtime friend, Brian Carey, Dr. Brian Carey, married your sister, Vicky, now Carey, used to be Vicky Azar. So anyways, for those of you who don't know, that Steve is an incredible guy. He's been playing music for a long time. He has a sound he calls Delta. I mean, we're going to get into that a little bit more. But he's had 9 hits on the charts, big songs like I Don't Have to Be Me Till Monday. I can say that about myself a number of different times. Waiting on Joe, Sunshine, Soldier Song, and a bunch of others. So, Steve, first of all, welcome to the show. I'm so jacked up that you're here. And I want to go back to that quote that we're just talking about, the positivity. And in the music business, you know, you have your ups and you have your downs and you have your hits and you have your ones that don't go across. And especially right now with COVID, you know, I've wanted to ask somebody in the music business, like, how do you get through this with the right kind of, you know, positive spirit when there's a major, or really a mega timeout worldwide in terms of what you and I and everybody else can do. But in your case, going out and playing songs in front of everybody who loves to hear your music.
Well, the music business seems to always sort of be it gets it pretty hard, you know, from the streaming. We've had to understand that and accept it. You know, we're all in this one together. This has been obviously something that we've never experienced on such a global scale. So we're not feeling sorry for ourselves, a lot of my pals, but we're not used to being home as much as we've been. We found out we're a lot more handy than we are. So there's a positive to it, you know, whether we like it or not, but it's been interesting, shows, you know, I was just, texting back and forth with, Dina Carter, and, you know, everything's gone. So it's an unusual time, unprecedented time for musicians. And I know there's been a lot of home concerts. I've done a lot of songs, you know, for different deals. I haven't put a concert on at my house. I felt like it was a little opportunistic maybe, or I don't know, maybe that's not the word. That's not fair to people that are doing it. But I feel like if we're going to do it, it'd be great to do it for a charity organization or something like that. And that's what I've been doing. And then, you know, just getting ready, making a new record. It's almost done. So, you know, in Mark, in these times, you sort of are forced sometimes to sort of have a moral check. Like, okay, are some of these things that I'm doing in my life, are they healthy for me and for my family and for our relationships? And sometimes you're taking the money for certain things. And this has been a really good time for me to just sort of view it all and just go, you know, maybe that's not good for me anymore. I think there's going to be, I think the impact of this, the positive impact that you talk about, positiveness, is going to be simplicity. I think that keeping up with the Joneses won't be as big of a deal, and that we're grateful to for our families and our friends. And the times we do get to hug them, man, that's a bonus. So I'm looking at that as a positive. When we come out of this, which we will, and when we do, I think that we're going to be a lot better off as mankind. I really do.
I agree with that. And I want to go back on a few of the things that you said, one of which you were talking about. You haven't played a whole lot and done live shows, and there's a great opportunity. Preparation meets opportunity, and that opportunity is right here, right today on this show. We'll call ourselves a charity, but hopefully we're going to get some tunes out of you today.
Oh, that's no. That's different. This is different.
I know. I'm only kidding you. But the second part of that is the positivity that I want to refer to, because you've always been a positive guy. And for those of you who haven't seen Steve Azar on stage, the guy is just a energizer bunny on stage, just running around, and really, you know, you're one of those few guys, I think, that really has that ability to connect with the audience, to talk to the audience, to then bring out this great energy. And you've got a really lot of fun songs. I love your songs. I love your songs even more live. You're one of those types of artists to me. And so that's been interesting. And then the last thing is, one of the things that's come out of this for me is that connection, you know, with other people. And for the first time in the alley, I'm meeting all these neighbors, because every day these people go out and they sit in these lawn chairs, you know, with their kids, and they're riding their bikes around in a circle. And it's just the hey, what's your name? What's your name? What are you doing? And you're discovering all these new friendships. So it's learning, almost kind of going back to the basics of the way that we communicate versus always being on your phone and texting and doing all this other stuff.
Yeah. Have you not? I mean, this has been, you're exactly right. And this is something that's happening all over. I've never seen more families walking together. It is like Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood right now, all over the place. And I just think that that is another example of the good that's going to come from this, that core family value. I just think that it's going to be pretty dang special when we come out of this. But listen, it'd be nicer if there was something a little bit easier on us all. You know, this has been tough on everybody. I mean, unless you're in the paper towel and toilet paper business, or the hand sanitizer business, or masks, you know, grocery store business and all that. But I mean, most of the business, I mean, I really worry about restaurants and music venues. And it just, I think about all of them. And we have a lot of friends some friends that have multiple restaurants all over the globe. I mean, a friend of mine has 300 restaurants. They're all over the place. What's going to happen? You know, and the impact on them, it's an interesting time, but you're right. I love seeing families together, walking around. You know, that's a beautiful thing.
Yeah, so a couple of weeks ago, we had Jim Mora, who's one of your buddies on the pod. Yeah, and one of the things that we're talking about is, or what he was talking about, is as we're going through this time today, we're talking on May 28th, and we're, I think, in a lot of these different communities around the U.S. and the world, we're starting to merge out of this period of time, and we're going through these different phases and unlocking ourselves. But we were really talking a couple of weeks ago about, you know, the ones that are going to really soar and go beyond this are the ones that were able to pivot and really think and take a time out about what's going on and how they can reinvent their business to some degree. Now, there's going to be some casualties along the way, yeah, for sure. It's unfortunate. It's awful. But at the same time, you know, I think what we're trying to do, again, taking the positivity out of it, is what is the opportunity? What is the opportunity for all of us? What is the opportunity for these businesses? And I think in your case, you know, what is the opportunity for the way you're going to emerge out of this with your song? So it might be sitting down and writing some song about COVID. I don't know. I don't know what that opportunity is. There's some magical moment.
In some sort of weird way, I've already done it. About to put it on a new record. But it's my way of doing it. So actually going to record it with Cedric Burnside, who's a legendary blues. His dad, grandfather was R.L. Burnside. And Cedric's the best. But we're about to, I may give you a sneak peek of it, but we're about to lay it down in June when they allow us in the studio. But yeah, I mean, you write from, Mark, as songwriters, man, you're so inspired by anything that gets you to, I mean, there's so many reasons why we go in and write a song. And a lot of times for me, it's out of despair. And then you add this, always had this silver lining, man. That's how I always write. And so it's been in that regard, I've always been tuned in, whether I like it or not, to go write about what's going on. You know, even if it's personal or with friends around me that are going through something, it's inspiring, you know, to write about it because it's real stuff.
I love that. And I love that about you because you've always been a real guy. You haven't been pretentious. It's been you. You've always been, you know, true to your friends. And that's why, you know, you are who you are. One of the things that I was going to ask, and you, I think you partially answered the question just now, was I was thinking back. So you've got these, you know, 9 or more songs that have been on the charts. I've got 0. That's still like my, So I look at you keep grinding away and you keep doing this, but my question was like, how do you come up with these songs? And you, again, you just partially answered it, you know, out of songs out of despair or some crazy situation come up that creates a thought. Is there something more to that? And then, you know, in terms of when you come up and you just lay down a basic track and you start laying in all these different layers with different sounds to create something very beautiful, like many of these different songs that you have, because you have all kinds of stuff going on, all these different textures.
Well, let's take a time out first and just say, you know, us musicians want to be athletes. You know that. And so
I know.
Question, how do you go run a post pattern when you know you're about to get hammered and concentrate? That's a lot harder than what I do. So trust me, what you have done in your life, that just blows my mind. I mean, I'm in awe of that. So, I mean, that takes crazy dedication. It takes being almost out of your mind and insane and invincible and dang good, like you spent your career doing. So I'm in awe of what you do. So I appreciate that. As a songwriter, you know, I love that how you use layers and all that. You write, you see the inspiration. Great songs come to you. You go through. So imagine, you know, you've been getting yourself in shape your whole life and you're getting ready and you're prepared and you've gone and you've worked out. You've gone through a spring, you've gone through training, your summer drills. You come back, you've gone through preseason. Right. Same thing for us. We've done it so many times that by midseason, we're doing it, that it's doing it for us. You know what I mean? We're running like on automatic. And when inspiration happens, you don't have to look for it. It finds you. You don't have to go sit down and go, I'm going to write a song. It makes you write the song. And then the song falls out. So after all of the years of doing it wrong when you're younger or barely getting it right or learning from the best, my mentors were legends as writers. And I was always drawn to them. Once you've been around them for so long and you learn the concepts of writing, and you learn to breathe and take a breath and let it come to you. And the song writes itself. That is the victory. That's when the good stuff happens. And then as you start recording, you hear some of the if, ands, and buts. I'm all about lyrics. So every but and if, it matters. I mean, it's the glue, those little words that glue everything together that make it make sense. So I'm very particular on that. And then when you're recording, you hear some of these mistakes lyrically that you fix. And when you're not looking for them, because you're finally getting to hear yourself back rather than sing it. You get to listen, you know, through speakers and you're going like, oh, that's wrong. And then then when you're building a song, man, it's like raising a kid. I mean, you know, the piano may not be suited for one kid or this Wurlitzer or a B3 organ, but it's sure right for the other. And I treat songs like that. The negative is when I was in Nashville and competing in a mainstream world, I didn't love compromising. So I figured out a way where I could do everything I wanted and add one element that would make me fit in this box, whether it was a steel guitar or whether it was this particular guitar player, and I'd bring him in to make it fit. But with that said, I'm making records. My last 3 or 4 records have been with no thought process at all. I'm not even thinking about genre. I finally know who I am. And there's a freedom about being honest as an artist. And so I think that's why I was able to go out and it worked with Bob Seger for so long. It worked with Reba McEntire for so long. It worked with Bobby Rush, you know, blues legend for so long, or Albert King when I was growing up. The one thing about growing up where I grew up is at some point you better be honest, because you're influenced by all of these gospel, blues, rock and roll. I mean, we are the birthplace of American music here, man, and country. So no matter what you do, you can't run from all of these influences. So you best find yourself. And when it comes, when you come out as an artist in the wash, you better be unique and sound like yourself and tell your story based off of all of these influences. And Mississippi's always been in the lead, in the forefront when it comes to musical history. So we found it at all. I mean, you can go from country to Jimmy Rogers to Elvis Presley and rock and roll. I was fortunate enough, you know, blues with B.B. King, every king there is. Spent time with Charlie Pride recently. I mean, just amazing. Think about the pioneer that he was. I mean, unbelievable his story. They didn't even show him on radio because they didn't want to let him know that he was African American. And you know, think about it. I mean, what he went through. I mean, there were obviously athletes that went through this as well, of color. So this state has been special. And, you know, one of my biggest things that I pride so much, and you hear me preach in Mississippi, is, well, first of all, through osmosis, I have a career. So I owe this place. Second of all, I've been the music and culture ambassador of the state for the last 3.5 years. And it has been like, it's the coolest thing, because I've learned so much about the value that we have as artists, our history has, and how it affects the economy. And, you know, we need that down here. So it's been pretty cool.
You know, really amazing. One of the crossovers when I used to play in the NFL, you know, it was amazing to me to be on the same field as Joe Montana, exactly, and Ronnie Lott and Jerry Rice and Dan Marino, and play against John Elway and all these type of guys. And when you're in that arena, you have that, you get that opportunity, right? And the one thing that's been really cool for you is you've got to go out and you've had the opportunity to play co-headline, or however you phrase that, with Bob Seger and all these other amazing acts. I know you've connected up with, hold on, I think Brad Paisley, Bob Seger, Carrie Underwood, Tim McGraw, you know, all these Hootie and the Blowfish. You know, these guys are all probably, you call them friends, right? They're on your fast dial.
Well, a handful of them are, you know, so it's been, yeah, it's been
good. But you're in that arena. What I'm saying is you're in that arena. And then, so that's one part of it. So that's really cool. And then, you know, you guys all draw different influences from each other. And then the other part of that is, like, who would have guessed that Mississippi, you know, some could argue is kind of the home of blues. As you know, I was down in New Orleans for a couple of years playing for the Saints. And yeah, I thought that was the birthplace, right? And Louisiana's got a great music scene, but Mississippi, where the hardcore, deep, deep Delta blues, where all that kicked off, was right there, right where you're living, in the right at the heart of Mississippi.
Yeah, I mean, Muddy Waters. I mean, we're doing a new music festival called the Mighty Roots Music Festival beginning October, and it's literally where Muddy lived, on the farm. And so, yeah, I mean, Robert Johnson. I mean, we can go back. I mean, it was Eugene Powell. When you walk in my house in the front door, you see a picture of Eugene Powell that was signed. And Eugene was a guy behind my dad's liquor store when I was 10 or 11 years old, that let me go back and just hang out with postmen every once in a while. But he was out there playing. And man, if you can't be inspired by that, that's why I got hooked. And just amazing. He was making blues records in the late 30s and 40s. Think about it. And then think about B.B. King had a tour bus in the 50s, maybe late 40s. I mean, that was you're talking about how music can get you out, how football and sports can get you out. And when I say get you out, make the world your stage, make the world your field.
I mean,
it's pretty cool, right? I mean, no matter where you come from and what despair, there is opportunity when you really work hard at a gift that you've been given. But let me tell you what, I know it like you do. I don't care what anybody says. I don't care how great your gift is. If you don't work harder than everybody, you got no shot. You really don't. Not to achieve what you're supposed to achieve. You know.
Well, it's usually, you know, there's no magic dust, right? It is literally that is the key to life. Is the hardest, there's always a correlation between the hardest worker usually makes the most money or does the best. You know, whatever that is, it's usually never the hardest worker does the worst. You know, those two normally don't counteract each other. Right? So listen, I want to talk about inspiration and talk about the path. I want to talk about a song called Sunshine. It's one of my favorite songs I've talked about. I want you to play it here in just a minute. It's while you're grabbing the guitar. I want to frame up a story for you, Steve. And first of all, it's an important story about this song, Sunshine. I want you to tell us a little bit about it. But Oprah had recommended this as part of her top 10 things to have on her show in terms of the album and featuring the song Sunshine. And that was an important moment because Oprah says anything about anything and, you know, it races out and it goes to the top of the charts or the best-selling book or whatever. And for me, I want you to know about when you start talking about inspiration, you know, kind of through my darkness and finding the light and discovering the mountains and then being on this whole quest to climb the seven summits. I really consider this like my summit song. I was on Denali, which is a mother of a mountain. It's located up in Alaska. It's literally the highest peak in North America. And it's a bear. I mean, it's cold. You've got the Bering Sea coming off. You've got the Arctic blast coming. It is awful. You're carrying 140 pounds up your back. It's, you know, it's probably twice. I don't know. It's a lot. Right. Yeah. And so the net is I was going for my summit day, I had this particular playlist, and on that playlist, I've got Sunshine. And there was a moment in time where I was really struggling. You know, I was going up and the altitude was getting to me and I was climbing this ice wall and I was trying to get over it and keep going. And there's all these obstacles out there. And that song came on and it gave me that lift to keep going and keep pursuing. And so you just, you know, kind of going back to the point you're trying to make, you never know when these little petals of inspiration can drop down on you and spring you forward. And for me, and I thank you for that. That's one of the things that really helped me, you know, move forward and on that climb.
You know, that was the fastest song that was ever written in history. I mean, it was the first night with Bob Seger of 46 nights at Grand Rapids. I'd been watching jazz all day. I'm watching the Food Network all day, listening to jazz music in the back of a cold by cold bus. I walked out, it was in fall, and it was just a dreary day getting cold outside. And I always write at soundcheck a lot. I'll just start writing something. A lot of my songs have started at soundcheck. But man, it's just so weird. I mean, it was sort of like not even a thought. Everybody goes, oh, you wrote that about your wife. I said, I mean, I'm sure in back in my mind, I'm always thinking about my wife, but I wasn't. I really wasn't. I mean, I was thinking about nothing. That just fell out. And it was so simple. And it's just interesting. You know, Taylor Swift said it was her favorite song in People magazine. That was like a big jolt. She talked about me being vulnerable and I went, oh, I like that. And then it was just a weird thing about that song. The video went number one and Reba had just recorded one of my songs and that I'd written and she was the VJ that night. And so she was talking about my song that she recorded, but this was the song that was number one. And then Oprah did her thing and then it was on the cover of Us Weekly or Us Magazine, whatever, as the wedding song of celebrities. And I'm like, what is happening? You know, and I guess it's just so simple, but I got to tell you, when I play it live. Okay. So first of all, understand this. This is one of those things that just like I said, practice, you practice and you get a gift. We literally, when I started playing that on stage, everybody joined in exactly like it is on the record, every single part. And when we got done with the tour, we raced in and recorded it. That was exactly what fell out of everybody's instruments. There was not one change. Isn't that crazy? I mean, and so, and it puts us in a hypnotic state. Every time I play it, I'm like, you know, with the whole song, it hypnotizes me, even me. I forget I'm playing it. So there's something that it never really goes anywhere. It just kind of lays. So yeah, it was pretty cool to write that.
And, well, why don't you hypnotize us?
Okay, we'll try
Sunshine.
Now, let me see if I can get a capo here. Let's see. Okay, so this was a little bit of a co-write. More than that, just my percussionist is my sidekick. So when I say I wrote this, I do write a lot of my songs by myself. But in this case, I co-wrote it. And so I guess it's a love song with my 5'7" conga player, Jason, who's like a brother, been with me 25 years. Your dark hair draped across my pillow says I finally got it right. And as I watch you dreaming twisted in the sheets, I can't stop thinking about last night. Well, I've waited so long, so long, so long for someone like you. And as this morning breaks through the window pane, it reveals the truth that baby, you're my sunshine, first light. Find your way to places that only know lies, failed tries and blue skies, with hardly time to hold on or be strong. I'm strong, cause like the dawn, you push it all the way. I tell you, you're my sunshine. Everybody needs a little sunshine. Your fingertips, a kiss to this tired face, it's like I'm young again. Well, I feel beautiful, but most of all vulnerable, since you broke in. And baby, you're my sunshine, first light. Find your way to places that only know lies, field tries, blue skies, with hardly time to hold on or be strong. I'm strong, cause like the dawn, you push it all the way. I tell you, you're my sunshine. Everybody needs a little sunshine. So won't you take me, take me, take me anywhere and everywhere you go. All the warmth you bring to this cold heart with the slightest touch is enough to know that baby, you're my sunshine. Everybody needs a little sunshine. Yeah, you're my sunshine. Like the dawn, you push it all the way. Did you make it up?
Oh man, you know, I'm serious. It took me back, and I remember, like, even deeper memory of when I was going up, and it was hard, and I was weighed on my back, and you know, that song came on, and it just got really teary, you know, as I was going, because it just gave me that inspiration to keep going and not stop.
The song keep you motivated and moving forward. That just
it's true. Mind.
Seems like you would need "Let's Hear It for the Boys" or something, you know, or like, well, fight.
Yeah, listen. Yeah, you didn't pull through this year, but I'm now you got another year with this whole COVID that I keep asking you about my summit song. Now that might be it at the end of the day.
Okay, well, maybe
sunshine, the summit song, or maybe there's something else. There's I can't remember, but last time you and I chatted, there's a song, and I'm not sure if it was Waiting on Joe or I Don't Have to Be Me Till Monday, but you literally were out mowing the lawn. So we go back to this whole, you know, idea. Yeah, Waiting on Joe. So, you know, you're out there, you're mowing the lawn, and of all things, when you're looking at weeds and making sure you don't hit a rock or whatever, right, why would this song come into your brain? Like, what is the inspiration around something like that? Now, Joe, we all mentioned, I can't remember if it's actually, you do have a brother named Joe, so maybe that was behind the music.
A little bit first verse. Yeah, second verse about what I was chasing. I was older, man. I hadn't had a hit. I was 36 years old at the time. I didn't have a hit till I was 38. So this was pivotal. If this doesn't happen Monday, I don't have to be me till Monday. As big of a hit as that's become and like a phenomenon last 20 years. If that never gets heard, if it wasn't for me cutting the grass, making sure I wasn't going to flip over sideways because I was on such a hill. And then I started really being concerned about what I was chasing, you know, and our third child was on the way, and I'd had a false start, like being on a bad football team. And I was a bad player, and it was all, we were all bad. You know, it was like, we were 0-16, but, and I couldn't let that be it for me. So Waiting on Joe came out, and man, it was a blessing. And then my Uncle Joe was, it was interesting. He was 33. He was a mayor of Clarksdale, Mississippi. Just an amazing man, my godfather. And he passed away of a bad, hard battle of cancer at 33. And so that Joe became him. So the three verses had nothing to do with each other. And I never thought it was ever going to be a song. It was just therapy. And then I was cutting the grass and the chorus came out, and I ran into the piano, which I'm awful at. And I was writing, you know, I didn't realize I was writing a song, but I was messing around on piano. And I did it, and then I went upstairs and recorded it, and the rest is history. It's just weird. Weird. Man.
Why don't you give us a little sampler?
A little bit of Joe?
Yeah, a little Joe.
Of course. We're supposed to start work down on the river today. But Joe and me is some pretty good pay. I was counting on him to be at the docks by 10. A week's pay says he's still at home, 'cause the boy's in his own time zone. I'm a-waiting on Joe. Oh, what do you know? Time flies fast and he is slower than I told him over and over. Now don't you be late. Oh, but like always, I'm just sitting on go and waiting on Joe. Hard to sing this one, kind of holding back. Towboat's leaving 'cause it don't care. Was not on board, and who's not there? Once that whistle blows down the mighty river, it rolls. Man, if I could be more like that, I'd get on with my life and never look back. Instead of waiting on Joe, it goes a little bit like that.
I love it. I love it. I love it. I love it. Hey, listen, what I want to do, it's such a beautiful song, such a beautiful song. I want to dip one more time back into your past. Okay. And then I want to jump into some of this Delta Blues stuff you're doing with the Kingsmen and all that stuff. And the song that has gone the furthest in terms of charts, over 3 million airplays. I Don't Have to Be me till Monday. Give us a little idea where this song, where this inspiration came.
You know, it was interesting. I had a friend that was my best friends from college, and he was killing it financially. But he was a great, probably arguably the best athlete I've ever seen in my life of any sports. You'd look at him and go, no way. He was on a golf scholarship, but he scored 71 in an intramural basketball game. I was coaching one year. I was coaching their team, 71. And it's just insane. But he won the racquetball championship every year on campus. It was insane, you know, football player, everything, but he was working himself to death. And when he shows up, he looks like he's 15, 20 years older than we should have been. Right. And so that weekend, we had a long weekend and we bowled, we played golf, played basketball, a lot of that. We went and played shot pool. We played pink. We did everything there was. And when he left, I noticed when I dropped him off at the airport, he looked young again. And I don't know what, you know, it's almost like he forgot, left it all behind. And man, he goes, it was just so good not to be myself. And that just lived with me. So there was a series of songs that were written, maybe 8 or 10 that were just not that good. But One Good Reason Why was on the Waiting on Joe record. And I Don't Have to Be Me Till Monday was also. And those were the two that stuck. But it's funny. And you know what the weird thing is? I was eating a bunch of Tootsie Rolls. And the song was called, you know, I'm Free. Or something. I was like, well, I can't do I'm Free. Tom Petty's done I'm Free. Yeah. And all of a sudden, we just one more time, and I just went, I don't have to be me till Monday. And then I went, what the? I apologized because I thought it was stupid. And the funny thing is, there's no way I ever have to. I mean, you couldn't send me into the room and go do research and figure out how to, the perfect title. It just fell out. And I would never say that. That's nothing I would ever say. And so I think once again, that was being gifted, gifted. When I say gifted, not me being gifted, being given a gift after working so hard and doing it wrong so much that you just work, you work, you work. And all of a sudden it just falls out. Because you're in the game. You're there. You're playing the game.
Well, let me talk about that before you just jump into the song. And that is, I think for everybody, it's this whole idea when you feel stuck, the best thing you can do is get out there and keep immersing yourself in society and things that you're doing. Now, I know things have been locked down a little bit, but that will pass.
Yeah.
Right? And I think the more that you do that, action creates reaction. And that reaction of if you hadn't participated in this kid's life, If you hadn't seen him do what he does, if you hadn't seen this reaction from having this really relaxing weekend and all these different things, it's just, you never know. Cause you're just storing chits in the bank. Right.
Right. That's exactly right. That's
yeah.
Got it. Yeah. Yeah. But it was, you know, so it was big, you know, who would have thought that he would have became the inspiration when I was in college? I mean, you know, he knew I was fighting for it back then. I had a band and we were working hard and we were trying back then, but it was, you're talking about 16 years later, you know, 15, 16 years later.
Well,
that's a time of doing it and not getting it right, you know?
Yeah. So from my perspective, and this is maybe what you're talking about before you had, you know, before Waiting on Joe came through is kind of the breakthrough. You know, you were struggling, you know, is this what I should even be doing?
Yeah.
You know, I just haven't made that leap yet. And it seemed to me, and this is, I think, a good lesson for all of us, is that you're putting the chits in the bank, but you were just in the wrong lane, right? And you're kind of playing more rock and roll, and that wasn't really the essence of who you are growing up in Mississippi. And so I think it took that introspection. You know, all those times that you're working and just, you know, honing your skill at playing notes and playing in a band and doing all those things, it all mattered at the end of the day. And so now you like leap forward, you know, where we are today in life, and you look back and without those times at LSU when I was coming up and you're playing, you know, fraternity parties and all that stuff, right? If you hadn't done all that, you wouldn't be where you are today. I mean, I think it's a big tie as part of your story.
Oh, there's no doubt. I mean, the bottom line was all those times. And listen, it's like being on a team and you can choose your team, right? You're drafted into this team, right? And it's who they are. And I was, even though you get to choose musicians, there wasn't a lot of choices and I wanted the best ones. And so your songs become, you're at the mercy of everybody around you. The beauty of where I am now in the last probably 10 years of my life, maybe longer, a little longer than that, probably 15 years, is I'm at the mercy of, the team has to rally around what I'm called, the plays I'm calling, I'm running the show. And that makes it right for me. And there's no way my audience is ever going to respond to anything else. So the good news was I was part of a bad team and I was bad too. So at some point you keep getting good and you finally get on a really good team and then you're rolling, you know, it's the same. And it's an analogy, I guess we're using, but it's a real one, you know? So yeah, I agree.
Yeah. So I want to come back to that song in just a second, but I just want to riff off one of the things. Like, again, this is springboarded into some other things. We talked about this before we went live. You've got a podcast called Mississippi Minute. Amazing guest on too, by the way, and Brett Favre and all these guys that have become friends of yours. Really interesting peeps, you know, to have on and really understand what their story is. And then you have that airplay. Now, I think you said you're on every county around Mississippi.
Yeah.
You're pretty much the governor, the key to every city up there.
Yeah. Well, Super Talk Mississippi's got, they're everywhere, but I guess you could choose not to play air my show, but yeah, we're almost in our third year. I mean, you've been on our show. The CEO of UPS, friend David Abney, just really great man. He's been on it. Our governors, last two governors, head of tourism, Craig Ray. I mean, you know, but then we've had Favre and just Michael Ruzioni was just on, you know, 40 Years of Miracle. He's an old pal. Yeah. He's got a new book called The Making of a Miracle. I just had John M. Berry, who's an old friend who just, he reached out to me to do a PSA for COVID. And I hadn't talked to him in a while. And his book, The Great Influenza, is back on the best New York Times bestsellers list. He wrote Rising Tide. He's a brilliant guy who was actually a football coach at Tulane when they beat LSU in the Orange Bowl. And he's just a great author. I've had so many. It's been a hoot. I mean, everybody's been on. You know, a lot of your pals have been on. A lot of football figures. Grant Fuhr, Bill Engvall. My buddy Gary Ballantyne from King of Queens, just so many great, just a lot of great stories. But through this In a Mississippi Minute, this podcast, you know, it's a podcast too. Man, I've learned to listen. It's awesome. And the stories can come from anywhere. So I've started to incorporate a lot of people that people don't know at all in the world of fame, but have done great things because they were dealt adversity and they came flying out of it. And that's where great stories come from. So this show's been really good. And I've got a new radio show we're launching, a country radio called the I Don't Have to Be Me Till Monday radio show. It's a weekend show for country radio. It's 4 hours. And we're going to incorporate some of these interviews. You'll be on there eventually or whatever. But then we're also going to have some big country stars on. But it's going to be me spinning the records and me playing what I want to play, talking to my old friends and the new ones coming up. And it's a lot of fun. So we're hoping that, you know, with this COVID thing, it slowed things down. We were going to launch in July, but out of respect to a lot of our friends who are losing work, you know, in radio, we stopped because it just wasn't the right thing to do to be opportunistic at the hands of so many of our people that helped us and our team on this, that are always so helpful, jumping in and go, okay, by the way, you're gone, but I'm going to take your 4 hours of radio. I just can't do it. Yeah. So we've had to call a timeout until everything gets right. Just in the name of doing something right, you know?
Well, as you said before, it's, you know, you're doing the right thing, number one. And number two, it's taken you a while, but now you're finally there where you're QB1, right? You're calling the shot. And so it's a great spot to be. All right. So let's spin it back and let's go back to that literally hit number two. Was it number one video, by the way?
Yeah, it went number one on the video, but it's awful. It got stuck. Houston, Texas wasn't playing it because they were mad at Shania, which is the truth. And they ended up being the first stations to ever play Waiting on Joe because they didn't know the story. So instead of me going to visit them, which I begged my label, they didn't want to let on that because she was the label mate, that apparently they had promised a show of her. They promised something and she didn't do it, or she hadn't done it yet. And they took it out on my record. And so, of course, they played the stew out of it since then. But because Houston weren't playing it, it was stuck at number two for weeks, you know, for a number of weeks. And so anyway, but, you know, let me tell you what, a number two party is no fun. It's awful. You know, it's finishing second in the Super Bowl.
I totally get it. You know, winning is fun. Losing sucks, right? Number two can suck. Hit the dots, right?
It's awful.
But you were still on the right trajectory.
Yeah, but let me ask you this. So everybody can hear Monday. I don't have to be on Monday and crank it right now. But what if I throw a curveball? And I'm going to do what you tell me. It's your show.
Yeah.
But we're talking about inspiration and this new thing. I mean, I'd love to share something, a little bit of something new to see what you think.
I want
to
do it.
Will you get mad at me if I hold off on Monday?
Heck no, man. Well, we can come back to Monday anytime.
I'm debuting it to the world right now, and it's in progress, so it's not done. Cedric Burnside and I are going to do this. Check this out. We're in cold water and we're in too deep. Yeah, we're in cold water. Say we're in too deep. These are chilling times, but I still believe. Someone call up the doctor, 'cause the fever won't let go. Someone call up the doctor, no, the fever won't let go. We are shaking and a-shivering, is as if hell has froze. Feels like cold
water, and we're in so deep. Yeah, we're in cold water. Yeah, we're in so deep. Now, these are troubled times, but I do believe the sky is crying. I hear her calling out to us. Lord, the sky is crying. Can't you hear her calling out to us? Goes a little bit like that. It goes,
I love it. Yeah. I love it. Cold water.
Might be the ghost of Big Time Sarah. Coming down to save our love. Anyway, it goes a little bit like that, and I'm almost done with it, but there you go.
So let's transition then over to the Kingsmen. So it's a really interesting collection. There's some guys that you brought in from B.B. King and Elvis, background singers and players that used to be with those two guys, and you wanted to go down and kind of recreate the experience, not singing their songs, but singing some brand new stuff, right, that you came out with. So is that cold in the Water? Is that song part of that collection?
No, it's just something I just wrote after the COVID thing. I mean, you know, so Cold Water's a town in Mississippi.
Okay.
I wrote Rena Laura. I'm looking for my guitar pick. Oh, yeah. I wrote Rena Laura, was another town in Mississippi. The new record's got Rosedale and Midnight, all towns. I've written Greenville. Indianola's been the name of an entire record.
Yep.
I see city signs, you know, the names on cities down here, and I get inspired, especially now. So I'm actually about to release a full length. I'm going to do an EP this summer. I've been the artist in resident at Delta State University, where I went to college, and we have this incredible music school, and it's full on. And for 9 years, I've been the artist in resident. And so I've been making my new record with some of the students and my band, and it's going to come out. And then a few of those songs are going to go on, including Cold Water, is going to go on the state wants me to do this record called My Mississippi Reunion. So all my Mississippi songs are going to be on a vinyl record on one place. And you can listen to it digitally as well. But Rena Laura is the song that's one of the town names that's on the Steve Azar and the Kingsmen.
Yeah. Well, why don't you give us a sample of something?
Let's see.
Highway 1 on my way down some fever trail. Eating on an Abe's barbecue outside Clarksdale. Lit Delta Divine, so suddenly stained. It was all I could do once she confessed. Her name was Say, hey, Rena Laura. I've been desperate for you. It took forever, it seemed, to find you. Less than a second for me to adore you, my Rena Laura. Forbidden fruit, dark to the rest of the world. Can't take the muddy water out of the girl. With Eve-like persuasion in her hallowed words, and that sting from those laden lips, I still feel them burn now. Hey, Rena Laura, I've been aching for you. It took forever, it seemed, to find you. Less than a second for me to adore you, my Rena Laura.
Something like that.
I love that. So when like I was trying to be in your band, part of the Kingsmen. Yeah. And so tell me we talked about layering in a little while ago. Tell me what kind of instruments are that you have. I mean, is there like steel drum or that, you know, obviously you must have a bass and some other things, but how are they complementing what you're trying to do?
Well, it's a lot of us. And you got to realize Walter King was BB's band leader for 25 years. He's his nephew, the sweetest man I've ever met in my life. He played on with Sting. It was Sting and those guys, but he also played on all the Angels. He arranged all the Angels of Harlem on U2's record. Yeah. I mean, this guy's amazing. Randy Jackson's brother, Herman's a drummer from Louisiana. Little Ray Neal, Rayford Neal's kid, one of the greatest guitar players, played with Little Milton for 30 years. BB's buddy, you know, it was insane. Elvis Presley's guy, David Briggs, played on 1,000 number one records. He was the original Muscle Shoals rhythm section. They all came down to Indianola, and there's a whole movie that we got our son to do while he was still in college. He's a filmmaker. And, you know, You Have to Do This, our son, Strack. And we went to Club Ebony in Indianola. That's where BB met his second wife. BB's second wife, she's in the film as well. And we turned that into this blues club, you know, back in the Chitlin' Circuit days. Everybody's played this stage. I mean, everybody, great. And we turned it into a recording studio, and the movie's called Something in the Water. And you can go to my YouTube channel and see it, or you can go to Aquello Stingray if you're there. PBS just aired it, and it's also on Go USA. But look, man, it was so much fun, and I realize I'm a little too serious at times and I'm watching myself, but we had a clock on us and we had to finish this thing. So it was great fun. And man, we toured a little bit together. It was a heavy band. And when I say that, you're talking about nine of us and everybody has to sleep in their own rooms. And for a band that nobody knew yet, you know what I mean? Even though they knew me and they knew those guys putting us together, we worked a lot, but just, you know, but it's been good though. It was a great experience. I think we all became friends, which was the beautiful part. Yeah. The band's insane. It's an insane band. You get to know every band member in the documentary.
That's awesome. That's awesome. I'm going to watch it. So what is the name, the title of that doc again?
Something in the Water.
Something in the Water.
Yep. And then the record, the album, it chronicles the making of Steve Azar and the Kingsmen down at the Liquor Store record.
Got it. So do you have plans to kind of get that band back together, or are you now on to your new creative project? You're talking about making a record this summer. What is that all about?
Well, I'm almost done with the record. I just wrote Cold Water. So I'm going to Cedric Burnside and I are going to go in and finish it. And it's a six song. I'm going to do a six song EP. And then I'm going to roll. I mean, I'm going to do this, my Mississippi reunion record, this compilation of all these songs, including some of the new ones, my Mississippi songs. And then I'm just going to, we're going to play. I mean, people are canceling shows still. So, I mean, they're canceling, like, you know, we're all the way through July now, the end of July. There's a couple things still happening, I hope. I'm supposed to be in Connecticut and Denver in the end of July, Connecticut. I'm supposed to be all over the map. And I was supposed to be in Seattle, actually, at the Triple Door doing a solo show the week they shut everything down. And I just played up in Astoria, Oregon, doing a cool thing. We'll see how she goes, you know.
Well, I'm going to be on a one-man mission to get you Sun Valley, Idaho, which is my new hometown.
I'm in.
Oh, it's a beautiful. Oh yeah, it's a 10. They love you, absolutely love you. I'm gonna
You know, some of the Kings. So what this ended up being is a couple of the Kings men, a few of them, you know, ended up being in my regular band now. So my old guys and some of the new guys, we're all one big happy family now, and we can do it all. So it's really worked out, and the band sounds great. It's funny, after the PBS special, we started getting calls like, this thing was 2 years ago, 2.5 years ago, like it was brand new. People, you know. Is there a way we can book Steve Azar and the Kingsmen? And I'm like cracking up going like, are you kidding? This was, you know, we said, yeah, we'll do it. So we're waiting to hear, but waiting to let us out so people can come see us.
Awesome. All right. So look, as we're rounding third base here going into home, why don't we go with that one tune that we talked about a little while ago? I Don't Have to Be Me Till Monday. It's such a great song. I get inspired by it every time. And just give us a little, you talked about it already. You talked about the reason, how the whole idea came up. So,
all right, let me see if I can do this. You know, these things are higher in my register. You got me. You know, you told me to loosen my voice up. I thought you were kidding. Here we go. Let's see if we do. Well, I got me a brand new car waiting in the driveway, shining like a bright new star. I've been wishing on it every day to take me away from here. So I called in to where I work, told a little white lie. No, my back don't really hurt. No, no, but that's my alibi. My temporary ticket to anywhere but there. Call it an early weekend. Call it going off the deep end. Call it what you want. I made up my mind. I don't have to be me till Monday, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. I ain't gonna face reality. 3 days without punching a time clock. 3 nights of going nonstop. No working all day. Well, I don't have to be me till Monday. Abbreviated version for you, Mark. Three days without punching a time clock. 3 nights going nonstop. No working all play. Well, I don't have to be me, I swear to God. I am not gonna be myself till Monday. I don't have to be me, I don't have to be me till Monday. You don't have to be you, I don't have to be me till Monday. I don't have to be me, I don't have to be me.
Yay!
I love it.
Awesome, dude. Awesome, awesome, awesome. All right. So people can find you at steveazar.com, I believe. Check and out
your sick of me at steveazar.com.
No, sir, what's that?
You can get sick of me at steveazar.com.
No. There's a lot of people who need to hear your inspiration, your music. You're on the right path. You know, you're saying all the right things. And, you know, it's just fun to watch the creative process, you know, evolve and develop and turn into a beautiful thing.
Oh man, I appreciate you letting me do abbreviated versions of songs too. So that you helped me. I appreciate you having me on your show, Mark. I'm a fan of yours and friend. And you're so inspiring what you're doing and just, you know, taking, you know, when you play a pro sport, like you did and having to stop and what you have to go through to just sort of reset, you know what I mean? You had to totally reset.
Reinvent
for time, and then all of a sudden you figured a way to a purpose, you know what I mean? And it's so inspiring, man. It just, and I appreciate everything, nice things you're saying about me. It means the world more than you know. And I'm really proud of you and how hard you've worked and what you're accomplishing. It's just amazing.
It's a process, you know.
It is.
never there. All right, buddy. Listen, thank you so much, Steve Azar. He's been on the pod. So great. We're going to run this on iTunes and everything else later on. But for everybody out there, Steve, you gave us a gift. Thank you so much.
You're my brother. Thank you, Marco.
Right on.
Hey, and thank you so much for listening to the Find Your Summit podcast. We are so glad to have you along for this journey. And if you enjoy the show, please tell a friend, share it on iTunes, spread it to the planet. We're looking to broadcast this to every person that is out there because, as you know, everybody has their own summit that they're going after. Okay, if you're looking to follow my journey, you can find that through my social links on markpattisonnfl.com. That's Mark, M-A-R-K, Pattison, P-A-T-T-I-S-O-N, nfl.com. So, until the next podcast, just remember, clear eyes, full hearts, and remember, it takes a little more to make a champion, so make it happen. Thank you. Bye.